last time your group didn't get time to defend, right, and present. Your group was presenting when we were out of, right? Okay, so what was their what was the topic? This one group keeps submitting two JPEGs, your group. Yeah. And one has a name, additional name in it, and other one doesn't have. I don't know why. Acha, okay. So he is a new addition. Acha, you were not there in the first session. Okay. So you thought it's an individual assignment. Ashish. So I'm keeping this with Ashish's name on there.
Yes.
Okay, so which one was yours? Which one was yours? The one you were pointing mistakes at there once.
Yeah.
Right. So
navigation.
Navigation. Huh. This one is yours. No, you were commenting on this and that didn't happen. What was your own? Okay, you are the same group. Sorry. Okay. And what was the one you were?
Internet connectivity.
Okay. So this one is yours. Okay. And who had pointed out? You had pointed out there. Acha, the last. So is there anything you wanted to add to what happened that day, or you have directly incorporated there based on the written comments?
One or two things is they have given suggestion for dongle in the.
The suggestion about dongle.
We have questioning about only what has been provided in IIT Bombay campus.
Acha, okay.
So that's so why you are only option for LAN and Wi-Fi.
You are limiting to what are existing. Options are available. Dongle becomes outlier for you right now. Fine. So you can like every topic also found out possible solutions to things. So they proposed one thing. You can think of or you can eliminate that. If you don't have a tab called solutions or suggestions, that's fine. You have to defend it finally, because when you present, you will be asked this question. So you can take a call. Do you want that tab or you don't want that tab? But that's how things are. And in fact, I have one sample, some overall observations about these things, which I wanted to share. And one striking observation is that by some way of randomization, every group has used a different tool to create mind maps. So no two mind maps are same. I don't know how you manage that, but that is amazing. Yeah, that just gives you a range of things which can happen if you use X tool. So you know what Coggle can do now, you know what XMind can do, what Busan can do, and various things, right? Some people, I think, used that was not a mind mapping tool, I suppose, especially the one here. So what was the tool used here? Is it a mind mapping tool? PowerPoint. Okay, so that is the reason, because of possibly wrong tool used, connectivity was an issue. So their things are like all over the place, and some things are even not connected. Now this metal is just hanging, there is a string attached to it, but it is not connected to anything. Because it's not a mind mapping tool, it's not mandatory to connect it. The PowerPoint is a drawing tool, or like you can connect it or you don't have to connect it. Whenever you put a tab in a mind map tool, it will always ask for a connection. It's very rare that it will allow you to just keep it isolated. So that's the choice you want to make. Also, there were some mind maps. Maybe I can show it here. So I already talked about this thing. One of the difference you can find out between this and possibly this one. Is that the chunking is unclear, like what is part of what is a question we can ask here. Although in color and in some shapes they have tried to do. What was your logic behind using certain shapes? So you have a hierarchy in shapes. So the central idea is hexagon followed by ellipses and then the rectangles or right. But it's not very evident which is the family of thought. So it's very difficult to figure out whether factory is part of sources or factory is part of how it is, because it's very nearer to this thing actually, although it is part of this. And this principle of placing things is called proximity. The human eye has a tendency to connect two things which are nearer to each other as a group, whether or not they belong to that group. So that is why you have to take umpteen number of times, you have to take care of this fact that if it is nearer to this, people will immediately associate a connection between these two rather than what it is actually connected to. Even if there is a line, it's very easy to connect these two things because proximity wise they are much nearer to each other. When you want to say that these things are apart from each other, actually place them up. That is the way you can. So like you can see here that if navigation and movement are completely away from each other, there is no confusion about which is navigation, which is movement. Similarly, these two are apart from each other, so there can be a problem about these things, but the line helps because there is a divider line in between, so people may not have that confusion, but just make sure of that. Similarly, this has easy chunking facility which you can see. So you can easily see that this is a group and this is a group. They have actually tried to use color, which is not printed here, obviously because we are doing a grayscale, but you can still see that there is a line and the hierarchy tries to show that. But one more example I wanted to show was this. Yeah, so very difficult to read, first of all. Can't read a thing in this until I printed it on A3, and then still I had trouble in doing this. If you save as a JPEG, still you have a problem. Probably PDF will help in such a case, but highly recommended that you don't use smaller fonts at all. Use bigger fonts as much as possible. Secondly, avoid this kind of hierarchy. For example, you have a clean hierarchy called pros and then there are subcategories. There is a clean hierarchy called cons and there are subcategories. Here there are just two strands going on. What are these? So is there, so I believe that these are added only because there was this suggestion came from some party, because I think the reviewers who did this thing, yours, right? And these were suggestions by the reviewers, right? So you just incorporated that into the mind map, but there is no thought applied further, like what category. You can refute the suggestion. There is no necessity that you have to apply that suggestion, but whenever you apply, it has to fall in your mind map as if it is your mind, your suggestion. It's not like, so do point dalne ko bole the, do point dal diye. That should not be the case right now, what it looks like. So chunking is a important, so these people have, I think, connected the majors now. Which group was this? Your group, right? So now the majors are connected and you can see this. Again, this was a problem case because the lines are absolutely not visible, because you can, thickness of the line is editable. Please use those features so that you can communicate strongly. For the waste management, this one. I thought I can use this example to illustrate certain things furthermore. And in fact, if we get some time, we can explore this in a tool called YED, which is a drawing tool, and we can just see a demo of that, because this is a classic example for YED. So I have tried to redesign this thing because I had a basic problem of chunking what are the main points of this mind map and then getting information out of this. So this is what I had come up with. Okay, so these are the three things: sources, how to effects, and how to dispose it. are the three major topics which they had already created, which I agree upon. The problem was with the second and third tier of agreement. So when you say sources, yeah, there are these sources and there are these types. Now types of waste and sources of waste, when there is no mapping between types of waste and sources of waste, then it becomes a standalone entity. So can we do that? Because types should be common for different sources. So house can generate plastic, food and recyclable waste. Similarly, hospital can also, the percentages might differ, but the types will remain most more or less common, and it's just a list. We don't have to actually map that house will only give this and kind of thing. It's not possible. So why not have sources of waste as these things, and then list the types of things so that people can think of the list as a separate thing. Similarly, if you have effects, where are these? Okay, so you had put it as harmful effects here, and there are a couple of them. So they are the same. However, when it comes to how waste is disposed, proper ways and improper ways, I thought this chunking is slightly confusing. It is within how it is disposed, you need to have proper and improper. You can't have three balloons called proper ways of disposing, improper ways of disposing, how it is disposed. So I just clubbed this idea to make it like this. So it is called how it is, how to dispose it, and there are proper and improper ways of doing it. And in further, you can say recycle and classification. And if within classification you find out that something has to be treated back to use, then there is a treatment bubble already there. So just connect it to this, and then you can show the microorganism as a treatment option here. Similarly, improper disposition of waste will lead to harmful effects also. So there has to be a connection between these two. So such things have to be thought of, where the secondary, tertiary level topics have some bearing on other things. So you have to create that association easily while showing the mind map. And why wired is because after you create such a complex thing on the software, wired will give you an option to easily clean it up for you. So you don't have to spend your time in alignment and all that. So we'll see a small 30-second demo of that, maybe if you get, otherwise I'll post it on the web and you can see it. Yeah, however, one interesting thing which happened here was, what I found is that there has to be a consistency in writing. So if you start with a style of writing, like you use a verb, or you use, so that consistency makes it easy for the user to read. So you have a differential way, like monitor energy uses, and suddenly install, this is also fine, but paste awareness posters in this thing, and initiative to shut down internet. So suddenly why initiative thing? So shut down. So if you are starting with verbs, paste this thing, so write it in a manner that it is easy to follow, that these are instructions to do that, rather than saying that suddenly this becomes a different sentence. Convert more devices, conducting, so you, instead of conduct, you say conduct here. So also the tense, everything has to be consistent when you write certain things, so that it is easy for the user to read, otherwise it creates a problem. And the most disturbing thing is if you find spelling mistakes in that. So I understand there could be some reasons for spellos, and sometimes the spell checker won't work and you are in a hurry. But it is as disturbing as then when I'm talking and this thing comes out, and instead of looking at me and what I'm saying, you constantly look here, right? So it is not intended. You don't want to look here. I don't want you to look here, right? But it just keeps your eye busy, and your mind just goes to that. So similarly, when I see something like this, I just say, okay, why F-E-A-T-R-U-R-E-S, why that? And that is not expected, because you want to read a document for the content of it, and you don't want to get disturbed by such smaller nitty-gritties. It's very important. It's very small at times, but it's very important. It just takes away the beauty of the content because of such silly mistakes. So try to avoid them as much as you can. Okay, so we have come to the point where we have the bulleted details about the presentation. And now we are going to go ahead with including graphics or how to make our point more clearer is the topic we are going to talk about. When we come to using of graphics, there are various notions attached to it. For example, people find it disturbing to have a graphic as well as text going together. But they say that it has unnecessary cognitive load for people. Why you want to show all that? But there are rules established for that, and we are going to talk about some of them. So which graphics will support a particular type of communication is well established and researched area. So there are different types of graphics, and broadly categorized they could be static graphics and the motion graphics. Now motion graphics includes all the video parts, including animation and interactivity, and all that is motion. And static are mostly drawings and photographs and charts and all that. I have given a reference of that. You can, by the way, I am going to put up these slides on Moodle so you can download them, because you can't probably read here, but I am going to show them separately also. This is one of the most abusive use of graphics, which is called decorative graphics. So most of the time, this you can see this application in newspapers. So budget session, we'll put some graph, that's all. Whether it is going down, up, doesn't matter. People understand it is about finance, it is about Sensex going up, whatever. Even though it is thing to do with, even if it could be amount of oil extracted from that particular rig in 1992, doesn't matter. People just see graph, they associate it with, okay, the Sensex going up. And that is why it is come up on the first page, because today is the budget day. So such kind of graphics have absolutely no bearing on the content. It is just for the decoration purpose. You don't want monotony of text. So you add some graphic to it. I have seen these kind of graphics being wrongly used, mostly in the seminar presentations for the title slide. So whether it is needed or not, you have some, because the template gave you some pastel lying here and some triangle and all that. So that comes at the first screen. Whether you are talking about mechatronics or something, still you can see that crayon icon and everything, because that was there in the template. They didn't bother to remove it, or you didn't change the template for that. That is not adding to any value to your content. So please remove it in such a case, or don't select that particular template if that is the situation. The second type of graphic is called representational graphic. This is actually how it shows in the realistic manner. So for example, there is a photograph of a chemical equipment, and the photograph will tell you what it looks like actually. There drawing also of the same thing. However, photograph represents reality if you have a person standing there to show the proportion of that. So this is a 14 feet high, by the way, but you can't take it out, right? That's a 14 feet high equipment, because you cannot see any reference to context, because there is no sense of proportion there. On the other side, screenshot is a fairly new way of representational graphic. It's a recent addition to the graphics, and that is useful because if you want to explain what happens here, if you right click on this screen and there will be a drop down with four options, which is extrude region, blah blah blah, if you have to write all that, instead of you simply say that refer to the image given below, which is a screenshot of the screen, and select the appropriate one from the drop down list as shown. That is more easy, because user can also see it for themselves. If they do it on that software right click, they can see the same thing. So screenshot is exact representation of what happens. This is a slightly offbeat graphic type, but I just included, because so how many people immediately do this when I ask you how many days in September? So this is associated with your memory, right? So you know that this is 30 days, 31 days. It's a mnemonic graphic. So you associate this hand with the meaning or the association of number of days. Similarly, there have been exercises in experiments where they have tried to see C for cat and try to make the shape of that. However, there are some claims of anti thing also. So what about C for cow? Then the kids will never remember C for cow, because you always say C for cat, then there is a problem. So you can't use it very frequently. But this is one of the graphics used. We all know about this organizational graphic. typical example of IIT Bombay map. Now you have this wonderful map by IDC Professor Mandarani. Do you use it? Do you have it on your mobiles? The app? Yeah, Insti map, right. So, although if it is not to scale, then what it tells you is only qualitative relationships. As against Uber, they'll tell you even quantitative, that it is 14.2 kilometers from here, and with current traffic, it will take so many hours and all that. It can go wrong by miles at times. But this is how they can generate information using the organized graphic, because you can get qualitative data. But when it comes to pure quantitative data, what is the type of graphic? If I have to ask you this question, so I want just quantitative data, right? Pie charts or bar charts, these will tell you exact quantitative data, how many people passed in this thing and failed and all that. And there are multiple options available here of how you can do this. These are called relational graphics because they talk about the relationship between two entities. So these are, that is, although the organizational graphics also talk about relationship, but this relationship is established only at a qualitative level. Main gate is far away from hostel 15. The far away can be said here, but if you convert this to a bar chart, distances between main gate and different hostels, and create a bar chart, you can see which is the highest and the lowest. So hostel 10 becomes the nearest, and so on and so forth. So actually get a quantitative relationship if you convert it into a relational graphic. So this is the difference. But there are some very interesting graphics also, and within static graphics, this is the graphic help avoiding a motion graphic also to be added. For example, you are writing a paper where you are not able to use a video or something. How do you explain a particular concept? So at this time, whenever there is a change over time, things are changing, so the pulley comes down and all. So then you can have figure A, B, C, or 1.1, 1.2, 1.3 to show that this happens at this point. And then that is called as transformational graphic, because it can change. A change over time is captured here. But if you have multiple forces acting at the same time, probably this is the best one. It's called the interpretive graphic, because it gives the user the option to figure out. And you can direct the user by adding color and adding arrows and say, okay, now if this happens in the turbine, then this will happen. So all this if cases and then cases can be applied with just a simple graphic, which is called interpretive graphic, and it can illustrate a process within that graphic itself. And if you want to have, if there are drastic changes over time, you can mix up interpretive with the earlier one and show 2-3 cases of that. That's also possible. So roughly, this is the mapping of what will be useful at what time. And on the left hand side, what you see is types of content. Now this is again taken up from a reference which I have given at the bottom. So these are broadly categorized as types of content. So if you are stating a fact or a concept, principle, process and a procedure, these are in higher order of complexity. So right from a fact, like you say, okay, there was huge crowd when the fire broke up in IIT Bombay. If that is a fact, you are just stating that. In the representational graphic, like a photograph would be sufficient. You can say huge crowd is represented, but the moment you say that the crowd increased as the fire was growing up per hour, and then suddenly you want to show a relational graphic that, okay, how many people attended at this, or the number of tweets happening during the budget session, so what was the peak hour and all such things. So then you come to the graphics which are relational graphics, and you want to show qualitative or quantitative and all such things. So the moment you start talking about different content, you can see that the type of graphic will keep on changing. So remember this, this can be applied loosely, but especially when it comes to procedure, then you want to use dynamic visuals. So you have to actually show a video. We had a classic example of toy making videos. So we initially used pictures. So we clicked photographs of every stage, the four fold this, or origami, for example. fold this and then turn this and all that. Then the problem started happening that what happens in between the two pictures is not visible to the user. So they were getting confused that how come you get suddenly this way of folding. I can't get it here because I turned it like this. I can't click a photograph of this. So such things are lost in the, so whenever you have a long procedure, then dynamic visuals are the best medium to explain things. That's how things have come up. So when you say text to graphics, there are various things which can happen. So this is a very well established example by and there are smart draw people who have actually used it n number of times, that a table will not tell you lot of things. So if you just convert it to a chart, probably it will be better. But there are some problems with the table, and I saw this example in Professor Gaitonde's assignment or lecture somewhere. What's wrong with this table?
The poverty rates should be in the middle.
Yeah.
And the county should be in the middle, in the middle of the side column.
In the middle of the
side of the left side column.
Okay. About the decimals, there is a problem, right? Otherwise, you can't make out any sense. I mean, there are four digits after a decimal in some cases, and so how about this now? This looks much better, and you can infer quite faster if you get something like this. Similarly, it's a graph, perfectly accurate graph, no problems with the content or the data is not the problem here. Data is very correct, but still you cannot do a lot of inference from this. Why? The granularity is a problem, right? So what we don't want is anything above 15,000 is absolutely unnecessary. So change this to this much and you get much better picture. In fact, this small little ditch here was completely invisible when we were looking at that bigger thing, which was not necessary. So softwares will allow you to generate graphs at a click of a button. However, it depends on you what kind of attributes you are attaching to it. Otherwise, software is going to do a dumb job of creating a graph out of that. Even if you put 2 lakhs, it is going to create it in 1 second still. Doesn't have to wait on their calculation problems. If I have to draw, I will take a lot of time. But then how do you use this tool for the benefit of what we want to do is the primary question you have to ask yourself. And that's why using graphics becomes an important aspect. Okay, so this was the assignment, but we will, any questions so far, or we'll go to the impress part of it. Any questions? So when we come to impress, there are multiple variables suddenly. We have too many things to handle. Now I am, as I am talking about impress, I am expecting that you have a bulleted graphic, bulleted list with your presentation. So supposedly you have 5-6 slides of your presentation. I am expecting that they are bulleted in the sense they are chunked in a proper manner, that you have every slide has the respective number of bullets within that. You have also applied certain graphic usage techniques so that you have an appropriate graphic used at wherever it is necessary and the exact type of graphic which is necessary. Given all that, now is the time to think of how to impress people with the thing you have, because you have ensured that the content is correct and is also organized in a correct manner. You have come up to that level. Now is the time to think of whether you can present it in the manner where the people will be able to make sense out of it. And that is where a couple of things will come handy for you. One of them is the color scheme. Colors in general have various notions, therefore it carry meaning and it carries mood. So it is also very culturally prominent element of graphics, because it can have different meanings in different cultures also. So it's not very sure that you can go by one meaning and then go ahead universally you can present the same thing. It's not possible most of the time. Therefore, you can use this very basic guidelines about color. And one example you saw, most of the time when I started my laptop with this projection setup, that you could not read the heading itself because of the contrast levels of this machine is an issue. So they keep it on this, you hardly can see the heading, right? and now if I keep it like this, you can see it. It is because of the contrast levels. Now, this is something I have to learn when I present at various places. Is my template allowing me to do all that thing is very important. Plus, I should be aware of what to click there in order to make it perfect in the way you want. So, this is important, but however, you can give this broad things of what should be the thing to read for people. And the thumb rule is contrast is more readability. So, black and white is easily readable. However, gray on white was not readable as black is there. And I wanted that to be gray because I am talking about the content here and the heading is okay, I can speak out. So that is fine. But that's a disaster at certain cases. By the way, the color dot on the top you can see would be the guideline slides. So in entire set of slides, wherever you see that green dot, those are the guideline slides. So even if in a slide sorter view, you can see some green dot slides, you can just copy same separately probably. Similarly, this is the interesting thing, you should study where you are going to present. If it is a dark room and you use this kind of a presentation where you have the white background and black text, then people have to really open up their eyes too much and everything will be hitting them. So in that case, a dark background with white text is easy on eyes. So that is the reason you have seen Apple CEO presenting mostly on a black screen, right? If you have seen Steve Jobs presentations or any Apple presentation for that matter in their developer forum presentation every year what they have, it will be mostly black background and just couple of lines or words actually on the screen. It is because the entire hall is very, very dimly lit. You don't have much of lighting there. Therefore, the only thing which is visible is the text. So they say iPhone 6, that's all. So they don't want anything else to be seen. If you put this white background, then they will see that white thing first and not the iPhone 6 words. They want to do it other way around. So this depends on, but avoid vivid pale colors. This was a very common phenomena earlier on. Now that templates have improved, this is rare to see. But still people go for the brightest red possible in that color palette of 64 colors or something. So avoid that. Typically it is very difficult to project that red. It bleeds out, so never use that. When it comes to font, it's like a jungle out there because there's too many things to choose from. And people, I have seen them using various things and some bizarre mistakes happen during that. For example, something very casual has to be seen and one of the striking example is of designing certificates. So how many have you participated in events and created certificates? One of the biggest mistake people do is use a calligraphic font in all capitals. So it's very difficult to read that. So if you see this word certificate is most of the time, so you will have this C and then you will have, and then you will have this. So it's very difficult to read what this word is, right? Because it's all calligraphic and all capitals. So you have to be very choosy while you are creating the font. Although it looks very nice if you use the upper lower style of this. So you can use this well, but the moment it says that name of the person or something, then it really goes bonkers because of the style of the font is like that. It's not meant for using all caps, but people then suddenly realize and then they do second mistake of having more fonts in that same document. And then they will have one font for the name of the person because IIT Bombay uses certain font, they will use IIT Bombay, there is another example. Because in the running text, it will come conducted at IIT Bombay, then they will have all capitals of IIT Bombay in calligraphic font. Such mistakes are quite clearly seen and they are kind of disaster. So typography normally refers to three types of fonts and they are called so So these are the three broad category of fonts, which is called serif, sans serif, and script. The thumb rule is that for all reading, typically serif font is used for all reading material. Now, while reading, I mean you have to hold it in your hand. It's not like you are reading this also, by the way, but it is not about, this is display. So for all display type of thing, sans serif is the preferred thing. And script is only when you want to add any personalization. Do you know basic difference between these two at least? Or I will just show you one classic example. The serif font will have the edges like this at the top, right? On the other hand, sans serif font will have no such edges at the top, right? So this is the basic difference. Now script can differ, like you can have your own scripts also nowadays with the font generators. If you feel like your handwriting is something very iconic, you can create your own fonts. But this font is easy on eyes, especially on reading. So therefore, anything printed, any newspaper you pick up will typically use a serif font. Even at 8 point, it is quite readable. Whatever font size they are using is 8 point or 9 point. It's still usable, so readable. So that is why serif fonts are used. But the moment you go for far away viewing, then say sans serif is the most preferred one, right? Because it is so thick that you hardly miss out any content here. It's even thickness all over the place. That is the hallmark of a sans serif font. On the other side, this would be sharp at some points and thick and thin at various points. So this is called a serif font, right? So you just to pick up, what font will you pick for military word? How many people will pick up this first one? Okay, how many will they go with this? Okay, how many people will this? None of them, looks cartoonish. How many with this? You can give multiple choices also, doesn't matter. Okay, why this? The people who raised hand for this, why this? No reason, just like that. Okay. Okay, why the other one?
Because it has to be visible from a distance.
Okay, but if I give you a printed document about military,
yes.
You will use serif font?
Sans serif can be used for both the purposes, for reading as well as for...
Okay, no. So let us keep that debate for a while, that whether it is from a distance or not from a distance. The moment I utter this word military, how do you want that to be seen? On Will you ever use this font for a military? And do you know why you are not going to use that?
You have a respect for that word.
Yeah, but you can have respect even for this thing, right? So if I write Queen of England in this format, you will have respect for her, right? Or maybe Queen of Junagadh or something. I can write in this. But you won't use this for military. You are able to differentiate between the things, but you are not able to pinpoint why. And the reason is that you associate certain emotional value to the shapes of the font. So the decoration on this N, where you have something like this, looks very feminine and looks royal and all that. This is completely anti what principles we imagine for a military person, right? We don't expect military with these small decorations and all that. So that is why you don't associate this font with military at all. At the same time, if I say, will you associate this with military? How many people for this? So this is typically the military font because they use something called a stencil, where it is cut and on the barracks or any wooden packages and their trunks and all that, you will always find this type of, so they will have this, I will be like this. And then N will be like this, right? Because that is how they do a mass production of things. They don't have painter there which will keep on painting and all that. So they just do that stencil thing. So that is why even Nobody will use this pond. It's too casual. You don't associate military with casual things. You associate with discipline. So the pond should be straight all the time. You can't have like relaxing ponds for military. At the same time, for a neutral thing, the word neutral means that it has to be so neutral to everything that you can't associate any meaning with it. So the best choice for neutral could be maybe this or even this pond for neutral, because it has absolute no meaning. It's very dry, aerial, narrow, right? You don't have to worry about it. But using typography and using emphasis within typography is where you kind of find interesting hurdles. And one of them is to lend emphasis. How many people are novel readers here? Avid novel readers. Okay. So have you observed that novels invariably will be printed in a single font, single color, without any graphic except for that cover graphic, which is multicolored at time. But you see a Harry Potter series or any other thing for that matter, it's black and white and absolutely no way of emphasizing it. What is the maximum emphasis they use in that? So somebody said something to somebody, then they will probably, have you seen ever a bold font used in a novel except for the title? Never, right? In the written text there is nothing bold, but you can make out that the villain is shouting, right? Even if it is not bold and all that. But then when you present it somewhere else, you do that things, like for example, you do bold, you do italics, you do underlining, you do color change, and the worst is that you put all of them together in one, right? You see, there are things where it is bold, underline, italics and colored also. You don't require this much of overemphasis. If you are writing in a particular manner and it is clear, then you don't require these many emphasizing options. The reason is that the way the narrative goes, people, okay, by the way, same question. How many people love the movies which were created on the same novels? You love them? Or you love the novel? How many people loved still the novels than the movies? Right? Why is that?
But I found it in movies, some clips is missing.
Okay. Why you didn't like the movie?
It's more indulging.
More indulging. The novel was more indulging than the movie. Okay, you read the novel and saw the movie both.
And all the aspects in the novel couldn't, like, they won't incorporate everything into the movie.
Yeah, that is the job of the movie making. They can't do something else, right? They have to do what was there in the novel. But then why did you like the movie than the novel?
Because we can imagine.
Huh?
We can imagine what we
can read our own.
Yeah, but in the movie you imagined it, or in the novel reading you imagined it?
Novel reading.
Novel reading, exactly. That's the answer most of the people in the world have given. I loved the novel as compared to the movie because I was free to imagine the way the den of the villain was depicted or written in the novel. I could think that it was some bizarre violet color inside, and I was very happy with the kind of tension which was created in that room when the intense meeting between the and the villain was going on. But when I see the movie, it was like all brightly lit, and they were not looking like henchmen to me at all. Maybe I didn't associate them with this thing. So it killed my imagination completely, and it suddenly became the director's imagination which I have to agree upon, and which not a lot of people won't agree upon. It is like, okay, you can show what you want to, but I don't agree with it. And I had some imagination in my mind. So that is how just the plain text of this type also gives you. Where is italics used most of the time? A foreign word is made italic because it is not an English word. So certain things are done, but like suddenly they say
in between a letter comes.
In between a
letter.
Letter.
An application or a letter comes.
Yeah. So anything foreign to what you are saying comes in. So you can italic it and then show that this is how it is. But then overemphasizing creates a big issue. And most of the time we do this mistake of overemphasizing. I have one interesting anecdote about this emphasize. So this was narrated to me by Professor Fatak. So he was in his early years of teaching, there is to be a process of writing a new question paper by hand, then giving it to the departmental typist who will type it, and then it will be cyclostyled, because there was no photocopying machine that time. There was something called cyclostyling, and that was done and then distributed in the class. So he wrote the paper by hand, went to the typist, and she was typing it. The moment she started the work, she just laughed at a point. So he asked curiously, what was the reason that you laughed at this? He said, nothing, I will go ahead. But he was persistent. He said, tell me why you laughed. He said, okay, if you ask me, I will tell you. You have written an instruction here. So typically the question paper will have set of instructions on the top. So what is that you have written here? So he said, use of calculators is strictly prohibited. So he said, what is there to laugh in this? So she said, what is prohibited? Prohibited means do not use. And what is strictly in that? Is there a slightly prohibited and moderately prohibited and strictly prohibited? Are there a range of prohibition? There is no range of prohibition. Prohibition means don't use calculators. There is nothing, there is no degree of prohibition there, right? So why use strictly word there? Because that is overemphasizing what you want to say. The moment you say prohibition, it's good enough. It just straightens the matter very easily. Why you use additional words like that? So this is a interesting example. Even in our word or sentence formation, we tend to use some unnecessary emphasizing words. So again, a guideline slide. Minimum fonts are advisable. Most of the time, a single font will suffice. But in presentations, you might require multiple fonts, which is a case at times. However, don't go beyond two fonts, whatever the document you are making, even if it is a poster or something. Don't go beyond two fonts at times. Very rarely you can use the third font. And use font options to make the differences within the level of content. If you want to emphasize something, then use these options. Alignment features, it's a personal choice and depends on the document you are creating. Left is more natural for all English readers because you go left to right. Justified is preferred by most of the technical papers, because do you know why justified was introduced? By the way, everybody knows justified, right? Okay, so justified is where you have these columns and you have this gutter in between, and then you have the text running over. Why was justified introduced, by the way? This has come from newspaper industry, because newspaper has 8 columns in the paper and there is no line like what I have drawn here. So the text should form a line itself, so that the reader doesn't start reading like this and then go beyond here and make completely different story out of it. To avoid that, this particular thing has to have an imaginary line, and that is when the justified thing was established. However, with technology, it has gone really bizarre nowadays. So if you have just one word, sometimes it will show you like something like this, right? This is bad, because it is not, or you have a word, then it will still phrase it like this. So that creates a very difficult reading problem for you. So whenever you don't have the issue of multiple columns in a document, avoid justified, because you don't have control over things at times. But if it is a paper and the template is provided, you hardly have a chance to change it. But for other documents, typically left aligning is better, because that just gives you the space, will give you the flow. It's very easy on eye. You don't have to be rigid about this entire block, which is very heavy for you to read. The last feature is very important, what I have said. Use grid. Every software nowadays allows a grid, and there is the option to snap to grid whenever you are operating within the software. However, I have seen very few people exercising this option. So one suggestion is that always use this grid on option whenever you are designing anything, especially presentations, and also switch on the option of snap to grid whenever you are working in PowerPoint or any other software for that matter, because that will help you in proper alignment without spending much time. But the software itself is going to take care of alignment for you. In fact, if you have seen this, so if I have such a drawing, and now I have added this and I have to align this, it will automatically give me these lines and tell me where to place it, right? And it will, if I leave it there, it will fix it into that position. That's very easy actually nowadays. Earlier it used to be manually done, and you used to have something called guidelines to be taken up from this scale here, and you just drag a guideline and it will come here, and then you manually do it. Now that is not the case. And once you have the presentation with these fonts and colors and everything in place, then comes the time when you actually project it, and that's when some additional features also come in into practice. And one of them which is very popular these days because of the advent of PowerPoint is the visual effects within this. Now a lot of people ask me the question, so I included segment in my lectures. Earlier I never used to have this segment, but then I included it on popular demand. So what to do with these animated text and other elements? So there are umpteen number of options available, not only for animation of the text, but you have it also for the transitions between the slides, and there are like these boxes turning and then door opening, and then there are something called some blast, and there is some, this is a very popular one, the page curl, which turns the page. There is some glows, and there are some 3D ones which will be very multicolor, dropping down and all that. But it will go to such an extent that you finally start thinking that when this presentation started, what was the topic of this? It will just take you away from what was going happening all over there, because you just keep watching this bizarre looking transitions in between. So let's go back probably. So the reason why you are presenting is you want the audience to take the message what you are trying to present. You want them to carry that with you. But what you don't want at all is they shouldn't be carried away by the message, like so much that they are taken away from the message, because all these things are remembered. So you just forget what was the thing. Maybe this is not the case with my presentation today, that you will remember all the transitions but not the guideline slides. So that is how you have to think of a presentation. Whenever you remember, you know, what is that you remember the most? So this is precisely what you want, and therefore what you have to choose between is the form and the function. This is a very popular debate happening most of the time. So how to show the message and what is the message? So you have to decide the message what you have in your mind, and then decide how to show it, because that is, you can't possibly dilute the message for the form. So that is important. Now for example, I ask you that show, give me examples of this category, bunch of crystals to clean or apply. I ask you this question, that what are the examples of this category of product? I want bunch of crystals either to clean or apply something. So what could be an example of this? Brush, right? Which brush? So when I say which brush, you will ask me what is the context of this brush. Like you tell me the context, I'll tell you the brush, right? So if I give you the context, I want it for teeth, I want it for face, and I want it for paper, then you'll have multiple options for everything, right? For teeth you will have a toothbrush, and for a face you can have the makeup brush or whatever, and for paper you can have the painting brush of different types. It depends. Again, in paper you will ask me whether it is watercolor or oil paint or whatever, then I will choose the different type of hair for that brush. It depends on what you want to do. The point here is that context becomes such a leading factor in all your presentations, that if you know whom you are presenting, what you are presenting, then you can choose the brush appropriately. It is not possible to mix up the context. So I can't use, possibly I try to use a toothbrush for painting sometimes, because I want to get some different texture, but I will never use a toothbrush for my makeup. It's just not possible to do that. It is not for that context. It is not made for that context. So presentations typically go down the drain most of the time because you are mismatching the context. Something else was expected and you present something else. That is where the thing goes bad most of the cases. So my take on this is that in this debate of form over function, It's not that one is the leader and one is the follower. It's both are important. However, it depends on how much attention you give to each of them. If you give less attention to either of them, then it will create ineffective communication. So if you have excellent content and you don't pay any attention to the presentation impress part, then you can see that it will not be effective as much. On the other side, you spend lot of time on the impress part without really making the content correct, then you can also fall flat on your face because the content itself lacks the integrity of the thing. So it is not that this or that, it is always an equal attention to both of them. It will only help you in the message across. So that is what I wanted to. And this chaos is a very common example where you can see, because you give excess attention to both. So if you have multiple colored slides with lots of graphics here and there and flying text here and there and lot of transitions, best of the content will turn into chaos just because of the presentation problems. So this is a very evident observation which I have found out. Therefore, the content for a given audience is a very important thing, although it is in the bracket, but it is important. It has to be read like this. So content for a given audience should govern the decision of choosing the style of what you are going to present in. And then there are three categories of that. What is the appropriate visual for that? What is the appropriate design? By design, you can club all other things like the fonts and the colors and backgrounds and whether it is a dim lit room or whatever. All that aesthetics come in that. And a suitable strategy is what is the presentation strategy. So whether I should have activity in between, whether I should ask a question, whether I should crack a joke, and all these things are dependent on that. By the way, somebody, I think Professor Patak only told me this in last lecture there. So one of his professors came to the class. He was a known mathematician who used to just use this board all the time and never even look back at students. He just comes there, takes a derivation, starts writing on this, fills up 5-6 boards during the class, goes away. Excellent mathematics teacher, people used to love that part. Somebody in the faculty meeting told him that it should be interactive and at times you should also crack some jokes in between. That makes teaching interesting for a student. The next time he comes, starts writing, suddenly says, oh, I remembered something, and then says, there was a cow with 6 legs, and then starts with the derivation rest of the day. So people didn't understand what was that. And then he said, oh, I was told to crack a joke in between, so I just tried something, but it didn't go well probably. Nobody laughed at this. So the students were too aghast by this sudden sentence. They never heard him say anything except for the derivation, what was happening. It depends on the strategy where you are using and then how well you can mix it up with the entire flow of this thing. It is not a kind of add-on that you have to have it on your phone, whether you need it or not. It's not like that. So you have to bring it up in the flow in such a way that it looks as if it was happening at that instance itself. For example, although I had decided that I will crack this joke here, I have to pretend as if I just remembered it, and because it is in the flow, I have just narrated it to you. It has to be like that. Even if you rehearse it well, even if I have told this joke 10 times earlier on in my earlier lectures, 11th time I have to again pretend it as if, oh, I heard a joke, so let me share it with you, kind of thing. And then you laugh. Otherwise, it won't be getting that kind of a response. So this is where the last part of impress, which I was making, is practice. If you don't practice, then it is very difficult to communicate. This is where I want to bring you back to. So after the visual effects and all these things will add to something which is called as appeal of the presentation. So what people take back is the appealing part. Okay, I remember these things because of all these things in place, right from the brainstorming up to the visual effects thing is summarized when it becomes a total presentation. That is where what is the carry takeaway thing for the people. But that will come only the last thing is done of practice. And I've seen most of the students doing this only maybe a couple of minutes before the presentation that, okay, just browse through the slides here and there and say, oh, I'm going to say this and have some papers in hand. I have to refer to this paper at this point. But it doesn't happen actually during the presentation because you have never practiced about it. You have never timed it. You have never thought of the questions to be asked at that point. What questions could come? You have never done a dry run in front of your friends who can pose interesting questions for you, and then you will be forced to think about it that, okay, this could be a possible question when I do the final presentation. All these things will have a bearing on that. For example, last time when we had a bad projector here, I sent out a mail to my staff saying that get a projector here this time, because I can't show visual effects with those bad projection systems, right? So that is, the practice told me that this place has a bad projection system, so don't use their projectors this time at least. In fact, I also carried a speaker with me because I wanted to do a small experiment about audio thing with you. Now I think we may have that time, but let's see. So this is important to know the context, the place, the people, and the topic, what you are going to see. That will change the way you present particular content. So that is what I wanted to share with you. I would be open for questions if you have any. So no questions is an indication of two things. One is that either you have understood everything or nothing, right? So I would be curious to know which of the case is this. Also, it is bizarre that in a communication skill class, there is no communication about what happened in the class. So your reflections about what we saw in last four sessions. Probably that is an appropriate sentence to say. Yeah.
Usually when we go twice in the class,
yeah,
people used to sleep.
We used to?
People used to sleep mostly, sir.
Sleep?
Yeah.
Okay.
And even if we go for the NPTEL videos also,
yeah,
after 5 minutes we start sleeping, sir.
Exactly. Okay.
So what we can remove this?
So you said two important sentences here.
One is that if we go with slides in the class, people sleep. So are you a teacher somewhere? Yeah, you was, and now you have come here for a PhD. Okay. So that is why now when I present, you can sleep in the class. But no, jokes apart. The point is, you have an audience and it's a mixed audience. So like they won't be at a similar level of interest at any given point in time. Some people might have come directly from a night out and a nice breakfast at Maddu Mess, and that is the most appropriate time with the ACs on and a lecture being given. So this is the best possible way of getting some rest. That is inevitable, but they would be like 1 or 2% in this thing. But there would be other people who have got up ready and gone for a jog and have a nice bath and come here all prepared that, okay, let us into what is. So there are these extremes which will always be there in any class or any audience for that matter. So you have to have a content for each and every person in the class. So occasionally I could see some people just dozing off, but then they laughed at some points because they associated with what I was saying. And this will happen in every point. So there is a graph of typical, which is called the engagement level of a person in the, so it's a very interesting graph, by the way. Let me show you that. And you should search about this thing more on the web, because if you are going to make presentations in future, you should know what happens. So this is typically of engagement. So when it starts, most of the time it is here. So this is engagement and this is time. So this is 0 minute and this is suppose 60 minutes. This is the peak point. Like around 10 minutes into the thing, you will always feel, wow, I am getting something. And slowly, if nothing comes at this point, then it just goes down. So what to do with this? Therefore, the ideal teacher will prepare for this slope. Ideal presenter will prepare for this slope, to address this slope part. And what they will do? They will have an activity in the middle of the class. If not, they will at least say, okay, now stretch up and okay, I'm just going to change some slides. You can talk to each other or whatever. It will just turn it like this. Then again, at this point, they will have another activity. So if there is the ditch, it will happen like this. So the think, pair, share, and review your assignments, all those things kept you in this peaks all the time, because there was no chance of sleeping. So that's how you plan your sessions. If you don't have anything like that, for example, in comparison to my earlier lectures, today's lecture had this graph. Because I didn't ask you to do anything, so I could see this happening after a point. Do you agree? Yes. And so if you agree, you slept. Okay, but doesn't matter. It's a learning thing for me, right? Every context has to have that. So I had an activity, but I couldn't do that. I didn't do that actually. Couldn't do that is the wrong sentence. I didn't do it. I had the equipment for that. I had a plan for that. If I had introduced that activity in between, there was a chance that this engagement level can boost up to this thing. So this is how you have to plan things. And the second sentence you said was very important, that after 5-10 minutes we feel sleepy, right? And this 5-10 minutes is universally agreed time frame of human engagement for any medium for that matter. And that is why even on TV serials, you have a break after 7 minutes. Because that is how they have to. So there are 3 chunks of the TV serial of 7 minutes each, which will become 22 minutes of episode. But if you show a 22 minute episode, try watching it 22 minutes of episode. You feel very boring. You don't actually feel that. Your brain cells start degrading after 7 minutes. So the break in between, the whatever Maggi sauce or whatever comes in between is not at all, even if you mutate and you don't want to do it, but that much action gives you a chance to be refreshed for the next set of 7 minutes. And that's what it is. So when you see the changes in educational field also, so from the NPTEL videos, exactly what you said, of these 1-hour lectures has been converted to MOOCs now. So the MOOCs video will never be beyond 15 minutes of videos. Ideally it will be below 10 minutes, but if not, at least 15 minutes. Because when you are isolated and watching your videos at home, we are pretty sure that you won't go beyond 7 minutes or 10 minutes of the duration. And that is when the production process has emerged in this way now, that the content has to be chunked into 7 minutes. Just because this class is like 1.5 hours, I have to prepare in a different way. Because I need to have these many peak points after every 7 minutes. Right? That is the challenge. That's what Professor Gaitonde. Yeah.
Based on their first electronics course of EDX, the video time I showed. Video time on the x axis, and the average watching time on the y axis.
Yes.
That time they recorded. No, that's not it. If everybody is attentive, you expect this to be 45-degree line.
It turns out that 5 minutes, 10 minutes, the graph went up to 60 minutes, and they found that it starts almost at 45, but soon deviates at about 8-10, and at here it's about 2 minutes, 1 to 2 minutes. The peak is at about between 8 and it's hazy because it's average. So if you take, this will be a broad stuff, but it is more or less like this. You expect it to be 45-degree, but it's nowhere there.
Any other question or reflection about these sessions? Do you agree with this now, what we just saw? Yeah.
You said that those scripts, personalization, what was that?
Any examples of script fonts?
Calligraphy, where we make our own fonts.
Any calligraphy font you can
tell? There's a font, brush script, like it's yes, a running yes. thing. And
you use mostly for any casual
book? Can't remember.
No, Times New Roman is a very, very formal serif font. But one of the fonts which is, I don't call it used, it's abused as a casual font, is Comic Sans. So anything you want to say casual, you will find that Comic Sans font coming up. It actually doesn't serve the purpose every time it is used. People just feel that it has to be used. So calligraphic fonts are for very, very personalized kind of messaging. You want to say, want to have a chai, so how will it look if I write that in Times New Roman or I write in Arial versus I write in a calligraphic font. So it just sets the mood differently because you know that this kind of a sentence is said by somebody in a very casual manner. Or if I say presentation timings, so it can't be like calligraphy, presentation timing. It has to be formal. So these are the different things. You should actually try to pick up some phrases and try to print it in different form, different fonts. Probably that can be one assignment you can think of. Let's see. I'll think over it. If we can get an assignment for certain common phrases in technical writing and see which font goes with what. Again, depends on application, like you said, if it has to be seen at a distance or read in a hand or something.
This may be mostly have the technical
syntaxes.
Yeah,
you have the technical
subjects. So for that, sir, we came here from the different institutes. So they have the different norms there, and we don't know about here. So we need some. Just I need particularly. I don't know about the others. Now we need a generalized thing that in what way the slide should be prepared for the technical presentation, so that it should be very effective and most
what,
of the.
What point do you use for technical?
Yeah, technical, mostly we are giving the technical seminars.
Giving mostly technical
yeah.
Examples of soft and space won't copy. Yeah. You won't get such phrases at all.
Yeah.
So the question is that what point should we stick to?
Stick to what is the basic thing that we need to prepare while preparing all this?
Okay. So the question is very clear that for technical subjects, because you will be dealing mostly with technical subjects, you will never be asked to create a slide presentation about Dabang or something. So you won't be encountering those issues. So what to write when we are presenting something on thermodynamics or mechatronics or something like that, very serious, formal, technical subject. The answer is in those guidelines. First is that use minimum fonts, never go beyond minimum fonts. Second is depends on application for reading. If it is going to be distributed, use serif fonts. If it is to be projected, use sans serif font. Within sans serif, there is an interesting anecdote I should tell you that Arial is supposed to be the most used font on the earth right now. And the reason being very bizarre reason behind it. When Microsoft launched Windows, they wanted a font which is a sans serif font. They also wanted a serif font because an operating system should come up with a couple of fonts so that people can use it as default fonts, and then you can install more fonts is another story. So they acquired Times New Roman for their operating system and they paid some amount. The most popular sans serif font at that time was called Helvetica, which is still the most popular font in the print medium. But Helvetica people flatly refused to give it because it was already sold to Apple, and therefore they said we are not going to give you Helvetica. So what Microsoft did was they ordered the font designers to design a replica of Helvetica and it should look similar so that people who use the computers should find a kind of a similar font available and then use it. That's why Arial is used most of the time. But the marketing trick they did was that they named it with a A so that it will come top of the order. So by default, even if you want to use Times Roman, it will always start in Arial, whatever you do in Windows, and then you have to go and change it to Times Roman. So that is how Arial became the most used font or abused font actually in the history of typography. And most of the designers, by the way, hate that so much that if they get a resume in Arial, they outrightly reject it. And by the way, the designers are very well equipped with this third eye, where they can figure out which is Arial and which is Helvetica just by the print, even if it is at 8 point. That's how they have developed this. Okay, so coming back to your question, if it is to be projected, so within sans serif or within serif also there are umpteen number of fonts. The choice is yours, up to what level of freedom you have to choose that. Okay, so here is one interesting guideline. You can choose any font for that matter on your laptop when you are using, like for example, I bring my laptop here and I connect it, I have absolutely no issues about the fonts because whatever is on my project laptop is going to be projected. The moment I make a PDF of this and send it to somebody and it is opened on a Windows or a Linux box, I am sure this font is going to be replaced by the internal font of that operating system, which happens in most of the cases, which you have experienced. That I send because I go to a conference, I don't carry my laptop and I just take a PDF and then I plug it there, and then suddenly something goes into script which I had never thought of, because it was not designed like that. But they don't have this Futura bold font there, so they will replace it with the nearest one in that alphabetical order. So if it is Frankfurter script, it will take up that, and then you have to manually go and say in some control settings that okay, change Frankfurter to Futura or Helvetica or Arial or something like that. So this is one of the most important thing you should remember, that font replacement is not in your hands. So when you do something, try to use the universally used fonts like Helvetica or Arial, and in serif you should use something called Times New Roman and Palatine. So maybe I should write these two sentences, if you can just take it down. So these are the most easy ones. So these are the two most popular fonts, and you will find these fonts on most of the systems in the world. So that way it is very safe to play around with these two fonts. However, if you carry your own laptop, then you can, there are umpteen, like I am using something called Futura here, which is a sans serif font, which is a very good sans serif font. And there are fonts like Bodoni in serif, which are very good. However, there are issues with every font, like you can't use them for different particular purpose. They are not suitable for certain purposes. Like for example, Bodoni is a very good looking font if you print it in the headings, but for running matter, Bodoni is very bad. So such things are to be debated on, like what you want, what is the application, depending on that you can choose what best you have to. Anything? Done. 11:10:57. Fine. Thank you.